to get started in terms of asking some questions, and I would encourage all the audience to participate in asking questions because there are many, many questions. If there are other people who have expertise on the subject in the audience, by all means, if there is a question and they also would like to take part in answering it, feel free. The questions don't always have to be answered only by the panel members here. There are other experts in the audience who could also address the answers to some of the questions. Let me start it off by asking a general question of all the experts sitting at the panel desk here. In terms of the various religious denominations in the Caribbean, do Christians go first in terms of the numbers, or do Hindus go, or do the Muslims go, or do the Buddhists go? Which one of these denominations are the highest in number, and what is the major religion that's being followed in the Caribbean? Can you use the microphone, please? Is that working?
It's not on, no. It's on? Oh, you can hear me? Oh, it's not loud enough. Thank you. I'm not obviously a sociologist or an anthropologist, but I've read statistics that seem to indicate that the largest group is in fact Christian, because there was a great movement of missionary work and a call to conversion among indentureds and African slaves and so forth. So I was looking into this in terms of, in fact, the Buddhist influence, and there's virtually, to my experience, not that much in the Caribbean. But what's very interesting about religion in the Caribbean is that, or in these Asian Caribbean communities, is that they're hybridized. So you'll have people who identify as Muslim, and they still will do Hindu celebrations, or they'll celebrate Christmas uniformly in Trinidad. Everyone celebrates Diwali, which is the Hindu festival of lights, regardless of one's religious background. But I think in terms of statistical numbers, most people self-identify as Christian, which is divided among Catholic, Presbyterian, and what's called their English Catholic or Anglican Church of England.
Thank you. Yes, sir. Could somebody handle the
On the average, it's about 25-30% Christian, 20% Muslims, which remain about the same from the time of the first immigration, and about 60-63% Hindus. That's my opinion.
Thank you.
I just brought with me the background note from Guyana, which is published by the U.S. Department of State, and it's only the figures for Guyana, so that's the source of the figures. But the breakdown they have for religion is Christian 57%, Hindu 33%, Muslim 9%, and other 1%. The site is managed by the Bureau of Public Affairs of the U.S. Department of State. It's not from Guyana.
But that's the total population that includes African Americans and everyone else.
Yes, it does.
Thank you very much. I have one request. Whoever is asking question or answering, could you please identify yourself except the panel members? We all know who they are. But from the audience, if you are asking a question or if you are answering something, could you please identify yourself? I'd appreciate that. Dr. Lukala, you wanted to say something?
Just briefly, for Trinidad, Christians are in the majority, but Roman Catholics are the actual majority, followed by Hindus, and then followed by the other religions, Christian and Muslim. But Roman Catholics are the numerical majority, followed by Hindus. And most of the Chinese, incidentally, are Roman Catholics.
Yes, sir. Could you speak up so that everybody can hear you?
My name is Chris Boyfadi. I'm from Australia. I lived in Australia for 30 years, and I lived here. Now I was reasonably aware of how Indians migrated to Fiji and other islands around Australia. When I come here, and I find a similar process taking place here. So I have one question. We talk about indentured labors, how British brought Indians on a ship. But ultimately, the decision of an individual citizen to decide, okay, let's get onto the ship. What are the factors that influence those individual guys to say, okay, I'll leave all my family and everything to get onto the ship?
See, there were three methods used in 1834.
Use the microphone, please.
Sorry, thanks. In 1834, to Mauritius, subsequently 1838 to Guyana, 1845 to Trinidad. Initially, the methods used were, number one, volunteers, people who were in search for a better life. The compelling reason for that would be that a father have to get his daughter married. He needs money, he needs gold, he needs cattle to pay that dowry under that system. The second way will be kidnapping in the early years, because the recruiters make money per person, or as they say, per head in those times. And coercion will be the next, whereby they will say, we're taking you to El Dorado, the city of gold, you'll have fresh drinking water, it's clean, you're going to make lots of money, you'll come back to India with gold. And to Indian families, to every family, gold is good. To Indian families, it's very special, because for dowry, that system of giving dowry at time of marriage was very important, to give gold and cattle. So these were the three methods. I know you're probably thinking that why should someone venture into a land or a place? But these people, they didn't know where they were going initially in 1834, 38, 45. They didn't know where they were going. They didn't know about the conditions naturally. And they didn't know that they were going there to replace slaves. Answer in? Okay.
I don't want to deflate that theory being promulgated here. But if we go back and look at the statistics and the data from the Fatal Razak that went to Trinidad, of the 140 persons that went, there were fewer than 10 persons who were 30 years of age and older. What I'm trying to say here is there are second reasons that friend Rohit brought up, coercion and kidnapping were the number one reason why. And case in point, we do an annual trip to India for 1 month in January. Last year, or the year before, we were able to successfully trace our roots in a village, Sarai Rasi, in UP, about 8 miles from Faizabad. And when we did all the work and plowed through the people in the village and whatnot, my paternal grandmother left there in 1897 at 17 years of age, and no one had any reason why she went. Her uncles, no one knew. So the second reason that Rohit presented, and the third, coercion, kidnapping, were probably the primary reasons, and not economic as those of us who are coming to America right now. Because if you look at the age group, they were not over 30. The majority were in their 16, the teens, and the low 20s. And they were not of the mind to make decisions at that time. But I'd like to make one observation. They all came from the railroad track. If you look back and look at Bengal, UP, Bihar, and we went to Ara, where the bulk, a good many came from. We went to a village of Kanda Chopra on Ara and the railroad track. Sarai Rasi and Faizabad were on the railroad track. So it's a matter of, like the Indians say, pakrade a child, and death for a couple pennies, they would take away.
And you
I
know,
don't,
and to
Rohit,
that point,
with all due respect, I know you've done a lot of work, but at first economic wouldn't you know, cut the mustard with me. Thank you.
Can I just say to that point, the British did enact laws. They were very aware that kidnapping or other questionable methods of coercion were used, and the British did in fact have to enact laws to prevent kidnapped indentureds. And they had, and someone who was going to present an indenture to a ship had to present paperwork to indicate that this person was able to make a decision to come. This was much later, and this was because of the kidnapping and the coercion that did happen.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Ejima Baker. I think we also need to sort of just aggregate this a little bit, because I think there's a very it's a very different situation with the female indentured servants and the male indentured servants. And I think it's really interesting that gender has not come up in this discussion at all. You think about men being brought in, this idea of a worker, of a servant, as a slave, that gender aspect needs to be discussed. And also, Asian immigration, I think, is assumed it's almost exclusively male, but it's not. There were a lot of women there, and women had very different reasons for coming to the Caribbean. And a big part of it was economic, but another part of it, for a lot of women, was cultural. I know my great-grandmother, her grandmother came pregnant and alone. Mm-hmm. And she made the decision to come from India to Trinidad. So you have women who come for very different reasons. I think we need to sort of pull this apart and tease apart those reasons, which have very different economic and social bases as well.
Thank you. I think you raise a very interesting question, which has not been addressed in any detail so far. Perhaps some one of the panel members might be able to shed light on this.
Go ahead. Yeah.
I'll try again. Initially in 1838, when Gladstone wrote to Calcutta 2 years before, requesting the coolies be shipped as human cargo to the Caribbean, the West Indies, he asked that a limited number of women be sent, one woman to about 10 men, so that they could sort of cook and clean. And eventually what would happen is the women were also sent to the fields. It was not uncommon that women would give birth while working in the fields in those years, as you would know. And as time went on, you're looking to sort of have a discussion on women who volunteered, right?
Well, I mean, I just want to point out that men have for very different reasons. I think we need to talk about that as well.
Right, yeah. So that I give to Dr. Gosai to tell you about the volunteers.
I don't know if you want me to say anything about the Chinese.
Yes.
But what was noticeable in the indenture period was that just slightly less than 3,000 of the 18,000 people who came as sugar workers were female. I think that percentage was unusually high, considering that it was an indenture experiment. And it had to do with the fact that the British tried to encourage family migration. It had to do with the fact that most of the actual recruiters of the Chinese were missionaries, and some of these Christian missionaries, and they were helping families dislocated by the Taiping Rebellion and the Clan Wars to migrate elsewhere. And another interesting thing I discovered, well, I didn't discover it, but a PhD student at Berkeley, who wrote on Guyana, made the point, and that's where I discovered it, that some of these same missionary groups who were assisting families to relocate to Guyana were also sending some of these families to Hawaii. The same groups sending the same people to different destinations. So that's interesting, I think.
That's a good question.
Yes, ma'am.
My name is Michelle Verma. I didn't introduce myself before. I'm a doctoral candidate at Teachers College, Columbia University, and I'm researching Hindu temples in Queens presently. And I had a question for Mrs. Ganeshram. What I've been observing is at temple celebrations that there's a very
standard fare of dal puri, spinach, pumpkin, bitter gourd, certain dishes that are just reoccurring, and I was wondering if that menu goes across the Caribbean in terms of Trinidad and Guyanese, whether there's any differences, and if you have any insight into the standardization of that fare as appropriate for religious functions.
I would say that menu is pretty standard. Hindu religious food tends to be simple, without a lot of elaborate preparation. Of course, it has to be vegetarian. There is usually not even a milk product involved, usually. And the reason that you'll find those particular items across the Caribbean and in Guyana is because if you look at them, they're indigenous or relatively indigenous foods to the Caribbean. Pumpkin, or it's actually calabaza. It's not pumpkin as Americans know it. It's calabaza. Things like what we call ground provisions and so forth. Of course, there are items that you'll see that are from India as well. They grow in India. What bhaji, which is spinach. I'm sure you've seen that there, okra, the bitter gourd, the bitter melon, and so forth. But the reason for the standardization is, so it's two things. It's one, based on what was readily available. Readily available also translates to cheap to grow. These were poor people. Ground provision and these vegetables grow quickly, and they grow plentifully. And the simplicity necessary in the foods of a religious ceremony. I'm sure that there is some deviation in terms of spicing a little bit, but again, these are not heavily spiced foods, so that's going to be, in my experience, relatively minimal as well.
Yes, sir. Way in the back over there.
My name is Fouquet Dumeta. I'm an author and a journalist. I had a question for the panel. What is the incidence of intermarriage in the different Caribbean communities, and how are the communities? How did they maintain their separate ethnic identity?
I'm not sure if all the audience heard your question. It had to do with the intermarriages of different people who went to the Caribbean. Open for the panel to answer the question.
I think you're more qualified than I am. Dr. Lukalai
wants to take it.
I think the Chinese tend to intermarry more than the Indians. I think that's a well-known fact. Not quite to the extent that the average Trinidadian tends to believe, but there is a sizable pure ethnics. Well, I'm just making this point as a fact. Right? But there is a lot of intermarriage. And the Chinese are less, while there's a general, well, the immigrants anyway, while there's a general group prejudice towards other groups, it doesn't actually translate a lot into reality where the children are concerned. And in fact, the more mobile they are and the more professionally educated they are, their prejudice tends to develop in a typical direction. That's to say they're more pro-white than pro-Chinese. But that's another issue. That's the extent to which they have become assimilated.
And I think it's important to point out that often in these countries, when you see the statistics of the breakdown, the racial breakdown, it's a tricky thing because it's based on self-identification. So often you'll have people who clearly have mixed blood, but they may physically appear to be one or the other, and so that's what they identify with. And it's also in the everyday verbiage. You know, like if you're in Trinidad, it's very common to say, "Oh yeah, well that Chinese fellow." And he might be Chinese and African and Indian and all manner of things. So because it's self-identified, it's hard to say. But because of the self-identification, cultural preservation is largely, in my experience, based on what you self-identify with. So if you decide that you are a Chinese descent person, you might identify more strongly with that and therefore try to preserve the cultural heritage that comes from there.
Is Yes, ma'am.
I was wondering about the rates of migration, the secondary migration to the United States. Are there, it's my perception that there's a lot more, and it might just because of the where my research is located, which is the Richmond Hill, Jamaica area. I see a lot more Guyanese than Trinidadians. I was wondering, in terms of rates of migration, are they equal from both countries? Is one higher or lower? Are different ethnic groups migrating in different rates? And related to the food, I often see a lot of Trini roti shops, but less identifiable, like, or at least advertised as like Guyanese roti shops. Is there a difference in communities involved in terms of food entrepreneurialism?
I think that, well, first of all, what a lot of people don't discuss is, so we've discussed it kind of generally, that there are always a little bit of conflict between race groups and culture groups, right? So it's kind of natural that people come here and they want to identify themselves as from their nation. You know, I'm Guyanese, I'm Trinidadian, or what have you. And both will tell you that their food is better, even though it's virtually the same thing, you know, the whole, and so on. So because Trinidadians are a minority, and my experience is why they identify their particular establishments as Trinidadian, roti, and so on. In terms of migration patterns, I couldn't say. The only thing I could assume is that, as a cousin of mine likes to say, Trinidadians love Trinidad. You know, they don't generally go, right? So the thing is, but Trinidad, on a practical level, is a wealthy country. Even though it's not necessarily seen in the social divide, there's oil in Trinidad. Trinidad, up until recently, and this is kind of political reasons, was fairly food self-sufficient. So really, most people, in my experience, left Trinidad for schooling, to go abroad to study, whereas Guyana has had a lot of unfortunate misfortune upon it, and so there was more migration for the practical purpose of survival, just anecdotally from what I've observed. But in terms of the food, because the Trinidadians tend to be the minority, is why they point out to one another, I am here, I'm another Trinidadian, but the food is similar.
Okay. Yeah.
My name is Prakash Singh. I'm at ex-University of Guyana. I have a group called Guyanese East Indian Civic Association.
Prakash, why don't you come up?
I'm sorry to disuse you, but there. We have an eminent scholar in our midst. Unfortunately, he's not here today. Dr. Mahim Hussain from Trinidad. He has been in the forefront of ethnic research. He did one of the most comprehensive surveys of all the communities where Caribbean East Indians are from. His figures in the 80s were that, state figures corroborated it, for legal migration, it was a little over 200,000 persons. Of that proportion, 65% were Guyanese, 35% associated with the name I'm Trinidadian, and there was a property of other groups. So it's in that kind of proportion. The Guyanese have tended to congregate those independent communities wherever they are, Dallas, Lauderdale, Richmond Hill, parts of Bronx. Trinidadians have been more dispersed. Workshops, however, have been underpoints. You know, they are around in that. Guyanese have no strict preference for a typical kind of food. Trinidadians have doubles and other shops. I don't know Guyanese having special Guyanese shop.
Well, I would say bakeries. Guyanese are very well known for their baked goods, and I would venture to say that that's their specialty.
All right.
To go back to the question regarding the migration. I came here in 66. In the early 60s and early 70s, the majority of my who were coming here were from Guyana, and they were generally the professional, the landowners, and the large farmers. Much unlike me, I came here right out of high school. First job in government, didn't like it, and the policeman came here. So when we came here, we had absolutely nothing to go on to build an industry or trade. The Guyanese men who came here at that time, and women, came as mature families who have had a business in Guyana. So when they came here, they got off the ground running in business. Trinidadians, on the other hand, we are now getting off the ground in retail business around Queens. So what has happened, now the political situation, and Prakash rightly said, it was politically driven to some extent from Guyana because we know the Trinidad situation, what have you. So during a good 15 years, Guyanese were leaving in droves and coming here because of the political situation in Guyana. And what the panelists also mentioned, that in Trinidad and Tobago felt comfortable because we had oil, we had gas, we had asphalt, and who wants to put America to be very clear. So those who were coming from Trinidad were the children of wealthy families, except me.
Except my father, too.
In colleges in America and Canada and what have you. And it only became later on in the 80s, when the Incoming Commission in Trinidad started in a downturn, that we had a proliferation. But if we go back and look at Brooklyn, what happened? A large number of African Trinidadians came up because of 25% unemployment. Mm-hmm. So if we go back and look at the Indians came for specific reasons, drop out like me, the one who the rich one, et cetera, but the Afro-Trinidadians came because of unemployment. So there's a whole mix of things why we came up here at that time.
Can I just give everybody the name of Dr. Gosain's book that was mentioned, Dr. Mahin Gosain's book? I believe the book that was where he did this research about immigration patterns is called The Coolie Connection from the Orient to the Occident, and it's Gosain, G-O-S-I-N-E. It's a very excellent book if you want to study these patterns of immigration, not just to the Caribbean, but to the rest of the world.
There are two authors here who did quite a lot of work. But still in Colombia, Walton Class did a lot of work in that area, and Linda Bash did a lot of work, did a lot of anthropology work in Trinidad, which is a good source of information.
Yeah, there are several people I recognize. Yeah.
Maybe I'll just speak very loudly here.
Yeah, please.
Madhulika Nirwal, I'm the director of Asian American Center at Queen's College, and my research is focused on South Asian communities, including the Indo-Caribbean population in Queens. I just wanted to make a quick observation and then a question. Observation is, in terms of the secondary migration of the Indo-Caribbean, the Asian Caribbeans to Queens and other parts of New York City, there's a tremendous amount of ethnicization. There's a new ethnic identity that's kind of emerging, which is not very straightforward in terms of Trinidadians and Guyana. But you know, you see all this kind of mixing happening. Are Indo-Caribbean specifically, are they South Asian? Are by that route Asian? They are Asian American in that sense. And in that context, there is coming together of the Trinidadian and the Guyanese identities that I see, and then mixing with other as well. Culturally, both culturally and in terms of activities and leadership and those kind of things. But the question is actually on Daryl Sude's behalf and my behalf too, is there is a lot of organizing happening around festivals. We see that in Queens and around Bhagwa and even around Diwali. And at that time, it is, like some of you even mentioned that, alluded to that, that it's not a very exclusive religious identity, but it is more the ethnic or the Caribbean, the West Indian identity that comes forward. So maybe some of you could talk about what happens when these festivals are celebrated. And there's a whole history of these festivals, not only Bhagwa and Diwali as Hindu festivals, but also Tajya around that it had been Caribbean. And now it's coming here, right? So maybe some of you could talk a little bit about the festivals.
Free promo.
It has become a social event.
And a community event. I mean, Bhagwa is now it's like one of the very well-known ethnic festivals. And then people from India or South Asia, they say, oh, we have Holi. And there's this kind of Holi / Bhagwa celebrations at the Queens Borough Hall or the city down. So I was thinking, like, if you could see migration in terms of the festivals also migrating.
I think what you see more in terms of festivals is actually acceptance by the larger community. I mean, I'm sure many of you who live in New York have at one time in your life gone to the San Gennaro Fest in Little Italy. That is a Catholic religious festival, and we all consider it very much part of our heritage as New Yorkers. And I think little by little, that's what you're going to see in terms of these festivals. But yes, you're right. The separation does exist to some extent right now, where there's Holi or Pagua. But as somebody said over here, it's a social event. You know, it's entertainment. People like to be entertained. So if someone tells you there's going to be music, there's going to be food, there's going to be suspended alternate side of the street parking, you're going to go, you know? And I think that what's going to happen is actually the identifications are going to break down little by little, and it's just going to become an event, a city event, a social event. But I myself don't particularly see any, let's say, I see East Indian, then Guyanese Trinidadian division. But not so much in terms of that's where I see it. I don't see like Trinidadian, then Guyanese, Indo-Trinidadian, Indo-Guyanese, then East Indian. I see the two together, and then East Indian. Yeah.
Yes, sir. You're next. Yeah.
My name is Paul Peterson. I'm with the Pathfinder Books. I had a question. One is for Dr. Lukbai. You mentioned the status of the Chinese in Trinidad and their place in high posts in government. I was wondering to what degree, both in the case of Trinidad and Guyana, the struggles for national independence and against imperialism and so on had an impact on the integration of the various groups that were brought to those countries and in the forging of a common national identity.
I think it's true to say that starting in the 60s in Guyana and continuing in the 70s with Trinidad and Jamaica, the majority of the Chinese community, who are basically largely upper middle class, reacted in a slightly muted version of what happened in Cuba. That's to say they were fearful, and a large migration out of the country began. So that they voted with their feet to a large extent. In fact, the communities in Jamaica and Trinidad virtually halved between 1970 and 1980. And in Guyana, it has actually gone down to about one-fifth of what they used to be in the 60s. So they have voted with their feet. And most of them have tended to end up in Canada. They're mainly in Toronto, but all over Canada, basically. That's their main outlet. But they're all over. But Canada is their main exit point. Since then, that has continued. And the communities have actually been getting smaller and smaller. Every census that has been taken since 1970 shows that in every single one of these territories, the Chinese communities have been getting smaller and smaller. And this, despite the fact of this new immigration that I was talking about earlier. And in fact, if you count in the new immigrants, it shows you how alarmingly the decline has been. Because if you add them to the census figures, it means that more people, more of the mainstream people have migrated. So that is the fact. It's continuing. Now, not necessarily due to political reasons, but probably more for social and economic reasons. Sort of upper middle class people wanting to take their children to Canada so that they can get tertiary education in Canada and so on. Despite that, and this is the irony about Trinidad, the numbers of people who have remained have shot right up the social ladder. So that even though the numbers are small, and that probably has something to do with Trinidadian culture and the political atmosphere in Trinidad. The regimes who have been there regardless of which ethnic group they have been, have generally tended to be very accommodating and encouraging to the Chinese in Trinidad. Unlike Jamaica, where there's a little bit of wariness and so on towards them still. And that probably explains how they have, why they have shot up so rapidly in Trinidad. The recent celebrations, for example, was totally endorsed by the whole country, by the government. They even made the thing a national holiday, which never took place in any of the other islands when they were celebrating their 150th. Right? So that gives you an idea. Even though their numbers are small, they are in, and I don't think they are aware of it themselves. I don't think there's a single country anywhere in the Americas where they are in those kinds of positions at that level of influence. I don't think they realize that themselves, because most of them are professional. They're not scholars and comparative analysts and so on.
There were more questions on this side. Yes, ma'am.
I had a question. I just wanted to know what the political relationship is, let's say, between India and Guyana and India and Trinidad. Is there a lot of interaction between two governments? Do they get along? Being that there's a connection?
Well, I don't think any of us could hear the question. Could you speak up a little bit more? Or
I think
come
she's
over
asking
here?
About the relationships heard? Between the governments of places like Guyana and India.
Right. If there's a connection, if they interact, if they have a relationship,
being
that in the past there was a connection between India and Guyana, India and Trinidad.
Right, yeah. Historically speaking, in the 60s, I believe it was, when Chatty Jagan from Guyana, then Premier, and Forbes Burnham, two members of, two political heads of Guyana, went to India. They went to India and they asked for help and so on. And the Indian government promised them some help. The years that would pass that we would find that Indira Gandhi will visit the region, continue to build some stronger bonds. But particular attention or help to those who were taken from India in the 19th century was not given by India in a major way. And I think that oversight, if it is by India, should be corrected. And recently, India advanced in soft loan, I think about $25 or $30 million to Guyana to build a cricket stadium for the World Cup. Unfortunate World Cup for for both India and West Indies and so on. And so I think the relationship, the current president of Guyana is Indian. I may point out, I think the first president of Guyana was Chinese, I think, right?
Arthur Chong.
Arthur Chong, yeah. And speaking proportionally of size of each ethnic groups, and a Portuguese gentleman, Peter de Guiar, industrialist, businessman, also assisted in sort of seizing power through proportional representation with the African-based party, the PNC, in 1964 election. So minority groups, or I should say less populated groups, also, you know, rose and took positions in those colonies, on those colonies. So Indian government is now paying more attention to places like Guyana. The Indian vice president was in Trinidad and Guyana last year. And he made some very important statements about working together with this territory and recognizing the people more. I think our good friend from Gopio, they have been taking many trips to India and sort of bringing more awareness about Caribbean Indians and people of that region. So it's helping, it's all helping, and it's improving. Relations are improved. But it's sad to say that it's only now that it's really happening. Prior to this little period of time, India totally, totally ignored those who left. When I visited India, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, and those areas, and I was hosted by the chief minister there, and while having dinner, and someone pointed out, but those who were taken to the West Indies, they were the lowest of caste. And I froze because I think Sharmas and so on are like, you know, I mean, they're not Chamars, quote unquote. But this gentleman was hinting that they're all the lower caste people that were taken there. Yet we have pandits and so on, right, over there. Yes, sure. Mm-hmm.
My name is Ashok Ramasaran from Guyana. I am Secretary General of the The relationship between India and the West Indies has, in the past two decades, vastly improved on cultural, academic, and on the economic front. And there have been more scholarships being given by India to all across the board, to Trinidad and Guyana, regardless of ethnic origin. And there's been a lot of bilateral trade starting, including business people for India who are bursting at the seams to invest in the Caribbean, as well as seek sources of energy and raw materials for India's booming economy. At the same time, India has an interest in the Caribbean because of its the Indians living there and its sort of mother sentiments, and it wants to see the Indians there be safe, which is a primary concern as well. At the same time, advance India's interest in the UN for more votes, and also to allow the Indian businessman to invest in the expanding economies of the Caribbean and South America. So there has been quite a lot of progress, and the Minister of Indian Overseas Affairs. Indian Overseas Indians, Ministry of Overseas Indian Affairs, is going there for four countries, Jamaica, Trinidad, Suriname, and Guyana, starting on May 27th, which is the arrival date in Jamaica. The 30th is in Trinidad, June 4th in Suriname. We'll miss the May 5th in Guyana, but we'll catch up another time. So there is quite a lot of activity,
a lot of interest, and relationship. Thank you. There are some questions on this side. I'm not quite sure. Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
I'm Donna. I'm from Queens College. I have a question for Professor Lok Lai. Whether the Chinese that came to Trinidad and Jamaica, were they primary of Hakka? You know, because even though they were from Canton, they were not really Native, they were considered outsiders, and they came in
because of that status. You'll find that to be the place more, the case.
Could you repeat the question so that everybody can hear?
Were the Chinese who came to the different territories in the Caribbean, were they mainly Hakka or were they Punti? Right. You'll find that to be the case in Jamaica. Definitely, and in Suriname. In fact, the history of Jamaican Chinese migration very closely parallels what happened in Mauritius. That's to say, a very small number of people, very small, less, just in the case of Jamaica, slightly over 1,000, in the case of Mauritius, slightly less than 1,000, came as indentureds, very small. And that was followed by the third wave, that's the merchant wave. And most of those merchants were Hakka, most of them, overwhelmingly. But in the case of Jamaica, however, the Hakkas came from just north of Hong Kong, that area, the eastern part of the Pearl River Delta. Whereas in the case of Mauritius, most of the Hakkas came from Moyen, which is the Hakka heartland up in the northeast portion of Guangdong, closer to the Fujian border, but they were all Hakkas. In the case of the other territories, they were mixed. Both Puntis and Hakkas came together. I have been told, but I haven't had a chance to verify this, that since the out-migrations from Trinidad in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s, there are now, as a result of that, there are now slightly more Hakka Chinese in Trinidad than there used than before. Before it was always primarily Punties from all the different sections with a minority of Hakkas. But I have been told that since those migrations to Canada, today, most of there are more Hakkas or Hakka descendants than Punti descendants. I haven't been able to verify that. It's not easy to verify either. You have to do a lot of family to family kind of thing. But that's what I've been told. So that migration, in other words, has affected the balance somewhat in some of the territories.
I actually have a question for you, Dr. Luklai, and that is, the way Indian descent people are now going back to India and trying to trace their heritage, are you seeing that at all in the Chinese Caribbean communities?
Yes, the rise of China has definitely had has been a source of pride to people in the region. Even people who, previous to this, knew nothing but a colonial education. Mm-hmm. I think the fact of China as a world power has had definitely a kind of a backward look kind of effect on a lot of people. As I said, that's among people who may not even have paid much attention to the Chinese heritage before. I think that's a phenomenon that you see going on globally. It's definitely there in the Caribbean. It's recognized too by the governments, because many of the governments see in that rediscovery or reconnection interest the local Chinese community as a kind of conduit to the Chinese government, with whom, of course, they would all like to have good relations. So that's the way it's certainly playing out in Trinidad.
Yes, ma'am.
My name is Rose. I was born in Trinidad, but my great-grandfather was in the States, but when he tried to return, did it on our business, and went to Trinidad to say hello to his cousins, and then came back to the States, came back in the States, I don't know how he did it. And then he left back again after World War II to go back to China. But my grandfather didn't leave China because he was nomadic, he was diplomatic. Revolution, communism, everybody ran like hell. What are Punties? That's a question I'd be asking. Because twice I mean, the Chinese that settled the States.
Well, all the mainstream Cantonese, whether they're from Toishan or Chungsan or the Samyap territories, they're all Punties. Because Punties is just a Cantonese word for locals, basically, as opposed to the Hakkas, who don't really belong to Guangdong per se. So they're sort of slightly outsiders. I mean, Hakkas mean guests, but that's a sort of Chinese euphemism for outsiders kind of thing. But everybody else is a Punti or a local, regardless of which district he comes from.
I never heard of that terminology on my grandmother.
Oh. Okay, well, she's a Punti. Yeah,
I mean, right. Yeah, but they never referred to themselves
as Punti. Oh, I see. Yeah. Okay, okay.
That's right. Terminology I learned.
Yeah, right. Yeah. It's common in among the immigrants. You're either a Punti or a Hakka.
My name is Murray Kahn. James Michener wrote a novel, Hawaii. For those people who are not aware of the Hakka people, if you read that novel, he did several chapters on the Hakka people.
Thank you. I have a question, and perhaps the panel can address it. I noticed that the names of the people who come from the Caribbean are spelled quite differently. Like, for example, the original name from India that I am familiar with is Prasad, P-R-A-S-A-D. But then when it comes through the Caribbean, it becomes Prasaud, P-R-A-S-A-U-D. That's only one example. There are other examples like Sukhdev. Sukhdeo is one of the organizers here. Where did this transformation of the spelling of these names take place? Like, for example, when a lot of people came to the United States, I was told that they were asked to change their names, make it simpler and stuff like that, although in recent years that has not happened. But somewhere along the way, there must have been some kind of a change. And of course, as far as I'm concerned, it makes it easier for me to recognize that this person is of Indian origin originally, but then he's from the Caribbean. Just look at the spelling and then I know right away. Right. Okay. Could the panel address this?
That change didn't happen only in the 19th century when Indians were brought. It also happened later on during British rule because, for instance, when the Indians were brought, they were signed to five-year contracts as indentured laborers. But they couldn't read and they couldn't write. So someone asks you, what's your name? And you say, Prasad. How is this British guy going to spell it? And you cannot spell it for sure, because you spell with your thumbprints. Yeah. So how is he going to spell Prasad? Well, as it's sung, and so that remains there, recorded. In later years, a century apart, under the British rule, the same thing would happen when they make birth certificates. They'll ask the parents, well, what's your child's name? Okay, his name is Ghulam or whatever name it is. And it's very difficult to spell that. So they will sort of write it as it's sung. And that's why there was a change of the character of the letters of the names. Now, in places like UP, a lot of names were changed to Singh.
That didn't change.
Yeah, lots of names.
Singh did not change. Well, if it changed, they still spell it S-I-N-G-H.
Well, if it changed to Singh, it would have been Chinese S-I-N-G. but a lot of people, it's interesting to know though that the name Singh is very, very popular, belonging to the Punjab region.
Right.
And it's interesting to note that Singh is probably one of the most popular of names in the West Indies. Those who came from UP, Bihar, not from this area. And I think Dr. Gosan maybe would, oh, you don't know. Okay. It'll be interesting, though, to find the reason why that name, Singh, that primarily belongs to the Punjab region, is so popular for people from UP, Bihar, and so on.
Yeah, I have a follow-up question. If you will excuse me, I will get you a chance, but whatever happened to the last names of the people who came? Did they have a last name, or they never came with a last name, and then they were given some whatever name that was available at that time? Because these days, when anybody comes as an immigrant, they have a last name, they have a first name, or as they call it, the surname or
right,
first name.
If you were to look at the ship list from right. the early years, you would find, your, as you correctly said, one name.
That's right.
And sometimes maybe you'll have, and it's totally wrong in spelling, by the way. If you see some of these names, the way they were spelled, I'm sure you might have seen some of those documents, or some of you might have gone through some of those documents. It's really, really, you know, if you were to take the term Hindustan as an example, the term Hindustan for what it represented in the British eyes, I think that's how they sort of went after those names in their spelling of a very local manner, per se, because we should remember the British Raj was very much there in India. There was a big presence of British in India. So they had a feel for these names, and many of them spoke Hindi also.
Yeah.
But in their own way, in their own, and they wrote those names pretty much close to their spelling. But to us who know the spelling of those names, they look very, very weird.
I think from
what I understand of the ship's registers is that many people didn't know their surname. They didn't go by a surname because they lived in a small village, and it's probably true in China as well, although that's more of a kind of very patronymic society. But so everybody knew what family and clan you were from, so you probably didn't use a surname. But one thing that's interesting, I know on a lot of the Trinidadian ship registers, you gave your first name and then your father's name, and that became your kind of, yes, it, like our name, Ganeshram, Ram was their father's name. So my great-grandfather and my great-uncle, so it says Ganeshram, Vishnu, Ram. And that became, Ganeshram became our last name. And there, in fact, are no Ganeshrams in Trinidad. And it's very interesting to me because people will say to me, that's not a last name. It's not a surname.
But where you're from in Madras, they do that. Right?
Yes.
Well, you see, the nomenclature of people from India, from different parts of India, is very different. Like, for example, if you come from the Tamil Nadu area, they really don't have a last name. Their father's name becomes their last name, and then it goes on. Whereas if you come from Andhra Pradesh, they all have a last name, and a first name is different, and so on. I mean, it depends upon where you're coming from. And also, how they put their names, the surname first, the first name last, or the other way around. Different parts of India are very different. And I can give you a big lecture, but I'm not going to do that, because there are people waiting to ask some more questions. And I recognize the lady over here first. Yes?
Teelucksingh also comes from Uttar Pradesh. It also comes from Bihar. And Rajputs are entitled to use Singh as well. And it's pronounced, it's spelled S-I-N-H, Singh, not Singh, for some communities, which is the original name. Also, Prasad is spelled differently in India. If you go to Delhi, some people are called Prasad, which is a mispronunciation. But they will do it, or S-H, you know, in the Gurdwara, they will say Prasad, S-H as opposed to Sad. So that's common.
But the Caribbean way of spelling Prasad is very different. I know the variations within India. It could be Prashad or Prasad or something like that. you want to make a comment, please?
I just wanted to add to what was going on about the names, because I think it's like food. To some extent, names can also lead into like understanding how the communities have been formed. And Ramin, I think you talked about this. In my student population in Queen's College, and in my interactions with Indo-Caribbean population, this question has come up about the last names that we have right now. And almost all the last names, not exclusively, but almost all of them would be first names in contemporary India, right? So whether it's Jageser or it's Mangru, you know somebody called Basudev Mangru. So those last names, I think, have come from the people who first migrated, the Jahazis, or people who were traveling, gave their first name, as you were saying, and that was recorded, and it became the last name, or the family name as such. And that tells us a lot about the recreation of family and communities in the diaspora. You know, how people have to really start from the very basic thing that they have, the first name of the person who migrated as such. I think it's very moving, because we see many of these, I would say similarities, not exactly the same thing, but similarities with the African migration as well. And what do you do in a land where you don't have roots? And how do you start a community? And names are like very interesting window into that.
I think I started on something that is too big. There are some people here, and we are getting a little bit late to have lunch, and I know that you are looking forward to the lunch, but just a couple of questions, and then we'll break for lunch, I promise you. Yes, sir.
Side to that, what if I say, I'm David O'Side, doctor is my nephew, that's the other one. I'm the people. Another side to that same argument, if I may. Some of those things are self-inflicted. And I speak myself again. I'm not using anyone as an example myself. In Hindu religion, a child is born, you go to the pundit. Pundit checks the book. They say, what Rasi name? Oh, D-D-To. So they what name? I become Dhomanan. My father couldn't read and write. So the pundit was to be blamed. He didn't spell it out. to go. So he gave my father, he wrote the registrar. Who is the registrar? English woman or Negro woman, most of the times. Here comes a little old Indian man, I got a boy. That's the top name. I got a boy. What's his name? The pundit said, Domanand. She put it D-O-H-A-N-A-N-D. When I became of age, I said, that didn't sound too good. Take my father and my mother to what we call a public notary here, over there the commissioner affidavit, signs affidavit. From here on in, he's called D-O-A-N-A-N-D. Damon. But another reason to be blamed, under the British system, our weddings were never recognized until Trinidad became independent. That has to be noted. It's very important. My parents got married on what's called bamboo. Mandap, the English in India. So according to the, I'm sorry for the expression, according to the white man out of England, that wedding is not legal. So what happened? I'm, in my birth certificate, illegitimate. And we are all from Trinidad. He characterized it because he had only yardstick, he meaning the Englishman, he had only yardstick what the legitimate wedding was. So we are all illegitimate. When Trinidad became independent, women who were 80 years of age had to go and remarry the husband. So these are some, there are a lot of reasons. And these are all vestiges of colonialism that we all are suffering.
You know, I have to say, sorry, the one thing that occurs to me is that in the Caribbean, not just in Asian Caribbean communities, in the Caribbean, we love nicknames, right? Everybody has their, right? They have their home name, they have their school name, they have their name with their friends and what have you. And I know, like with my own father, this caused a problem in terms of the actual spelling of his name in legal documents. His name was Krishnaram, right? No one knew that. His name was Sonny Boy to everybody, right? We did not have a name. We were just Sonny Boy Chiron. That was it, you know? So, but his, because of this, the people who registered his name, and, you know, people, it's not like here where they, maybe now it is, but in those days, he was born 1924, people didn't have all their documents nicely at home. He didn't have his birth certificate until he had to go get it, right? So he had no way of knowing that what the spelling was. So he became Krishnarayan, Krishanan, like anything you could possibly imagine. And part of this is because your identity is very much wrapped up in the nicknames and home names that you have. So you may not ever know, unless you had a reason in those days, what your legal name was. And so the spelling morphed and morphed and morphed over time.
Thank you. We'll have one last item, and then we'll break for lunch. Dr. Lal Motwani wanted to say something.
I just wanted to add to her about the names. There are so many different names in Hindus, especially they add some fix from the back, like Mohan Lal, Ramchand, Kishan Chand, then Kushi Ram, Mohan Das. So there are some different Das, Singh, Chand, Mal, and Singh also. So these are different identities from the different regions, like Sindh, which is now Pakistan. We had a Mal. If it's a good name, then we'll say Mohan Das. Das is means he's a Guru's Das, which is given a big respect over there. Sometimes we will call Ram in the back also, Mohan Lal, Mohan Ram, Chand. So these are the respectable in the back, not the last names. As she said, sometimes they call as a last name. These are not last names. These are just respect to the person. When he's born, he's young, they just call Lal. But when I become old, they call me Lal Chand. All Ram. So that comes respect. But the Motwani or the last names which comes, they comes mostly from the grandparents' name. We respect our grandparents and to give them a life and respect. So family names comes through the grandfather. And after certain times, some person don't like the grandfather. Oh no, he was not good. So he changed his name according to his grandfather or his father's name. So his name is a Mohan, is his name. So he called Mohan Das or Motumal or something different way. So these names comes according to that. I agree with that because of British rule at that time, they cannot pronounce the names properly. So they give the wrong name. We got a right example over here, Ashok. He write A-S-H-O-O-K, which we don't write in India. We write A-S-H-O-K. Mm-hmm. So there is a difference because they pronunciation is a different way. So this depends upon that.
That's
right.
Thank you very much.
How about, I do Mr. Have, Chairman, how about a little joke before we go for
please?
Lunch?
Jokes
little appetizing are joke. speaking of names, and it's a true one, true intermarriage that someone asked about earlier, we'll have a child, a son from an Indian woman and an African man in Guyana, known as Indo-Guyanese, Afro-Guyanese. So he was mixed. And when they had political tension in Guyana in 1964, leading up to 1964 elections, huge riots were taking place and the blacks were really getting furious with the Indians and the Indians were getting mad with the blacks and this whole political movement was taking place. So whoever looks like Indian, they get a good beating from the blacks. and finally they met this guy and he was... His mother was Indian, his father was black, so he's like what they call Dagla, like a mixed, and that's what they call them. And so they ask him, I mean, what are you, white or black or Indian? Because if he's Indian, they got to beat him up. So he said, well, my name is Ram John. So Ram is Indian, John is black. So they said, we'll beat Ram out of John. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I do have a lot of questions, but I'm going to defer them for a later time.